Hello, my name is Rachel Huddett and I'm a scientific curator at PharmGKB. In this video, we're going to do a walkthrough of the PharmGKB website. This video will cover the main features on the PharmGKB website, shorter videos which go over certain types of annotations in greater detail can be found in our YouTube playlist PharmGKB Walkthroughs. This is the PharmGKB homepage. Most visitors to PharmGKB are looking for information about a specific drug or gene. I'm going to use the search box to search for codeine. You'll see that suggestions appear as I type, or I can hit return and bring up the full list of search results. I'm interested in seeing everything that PharmGKB has on codeine, so I'm going to go to the codeine drug page. Every drug, gene, variant, and phenotype in PharmGKB has its own page like this one. The column on the left shows the different types of information that are available in PharmGKB, and the blue dots show that there is information relevant to, in this case, codeine. If we go to the page for the gene POR, you'll see that there aren't any drug label annotations or prescribing info related to this gene. Coming back to the codeine page, we're going to work our way down this column on the left to look at each of the annotation types in more detail. The prescribing info section shows clinical guideline annotations and drug label annotations with genotype-based prescribing information. PharmGKB annotates clinical guidelines from professional organisations such as Cpic and the DPWG. If the guideline gives a no recommendation for a gene drug pair, that's shown here as well as on the annotation itself and on the guideline annotations landing page, which we'll get to later in this video. We're going to take a closer look at each annotation to see some of the different features of our guideline annotations. This is an annotation of part of the Cpic opioids guideline, specifically looking at the relationship between the genes COMT and OPRM1 and selected opioids, including codeine. Each guideline annotation has a summary at the top, with a more detailed main annotation further down the page. Guideline annotations contain excerpts from the guideline, as well as useful tables covering the guideline content. As on the previous page, the no recommendation label is prominently displayed so that users are aware that there are no clinical recommendations available for using COMT or OPRM1 genotypes in opioid prescribing. All annotations on Cpic guidelines have video summaries which can also be found on the PharmGKB YouTube channel. Now we're going to take a look at the annotation of the Cpic guideline for codeine and CYP2D6. The Cpic opioids guideline has clinical recommendations for using CYP2D6 genotype information when prescribing codeine. All Cpic and DPWG guideline annotations with recommendations have this interactive tool at the top of the annotation, where you can enter a specific genotype and get the relevant recommendations. I'm going to put in *4*4. You'll see that the tool recognises this as a poor metabolizer genotype and gives me the relevant recommendation, the implications, and the strength of the recommendation. If I change one of the *4 alleles to be at least 3 copies of the *1 allele, the tool changes to show me the recommendations for an ultra-rapid metabolizer. Many annotations on PharmGKB have a history section at the bottom of the page, where you can see if any changes have been made to the annotation over time. Clinical guideline annotations also have a link to an expanded version of the annotation. This expanded version gives you more details about the guideline publication and how the annotation is connected to other objects in the PharmGKB database. I'm going to quickly show the DPWG annotation to highlight some other features. Some guidelines from DPWG and other organisations contain guidance about pharmacogenetic testing for the gene-drug pairs covered by the guideline. We mark these annotations with a testing info tag and include the information in the annotation. If we scroll down the annotation, you'll find a section on preemptive genotyping here. Switching back to the homepage briefly, this button takes you to a table showing all of our guideline annotations. This is ideal for users who want an overview of which drugs have pharmacogenetic guidelines. We're going to move on to the drug label annotations for codeine. PharmGKB annotates drug labels from around the world, including the US Food and Drug Administration and the European Medicines Agency. We're going to look at the annotation on the FDA label. PharmGKB assigns a PGX level to all drug label annotations. You can learn more about the different levels and how they're assigned by clicking on the eye icon. PharmGKB assigned the FDA label for codeine as actionable PGX. This means that there is information in the label about changes in efficacy, dosage, or toxicity due to genetic variant. As with guideline annotations, drug label annotations have a summary of the pharmacogenetic information in the drug label, followed by a more detailed annotation with excerpts from the label. If an FDA label is also in the FDA's table of pharmacogenetic associations, we display that information here. This link is at the bottom of each drug label annotation and lets you download a PDF of the drug label with information about pharmacogenetic and drug-drug interactions highlighted. Coming back to the homepage again, we have a drug label annotations table similar to the one for guideline annotations. You can access it by clicking this button. This shows you all of our drug label annotations separated by agency. You can see the PGX level assigned to each annotation and tags related to any pharmacogenetic prescribing guidance found in the label. You can click on the eye icon to learn more about each of the tags and how they're used on PharmGKB. We're going to take a brief break from annotations and look at the PharmGKB pathways. These are evidence-based illustrations of a drug's pharmacokinetics or pharmacodynamics and are accompanied by a literature review which also describes known pharmacogenetic associations relevant to the pathway. If we go into the codeine pathway, you'll see that the pathway image is at the top and the literature review is underneath. As part of creating these pathways, we produce GPML files that show the relationship between different components in the pathway, as well as the literature evidence supporting each relationship. That information is displayed in this table on the website. You can also download the original GPML file in addition to other files containing the pathway data. PharmGKB also has in-progress pathways. These are pathways which are still in development, but we've made the GPML data available to users. You can see a basic diagram of the pathway and the relationship data on the website. Coming back to the codeine pathway, all PharmGKB pathway images are interactive, so you can click on chemicals or genes shown in the pathway and be taken to the relevant page. I'm going to click on CYP2D6, which takes me to the CYP2D6 page. Another type of literature review that PharmGKB provides are our very important pharmacogene or VIP summaries. VIP summaries are reviews of genes which are considered to be particularly important in pharmacogenetics. They can be accessed through gene pages of genes which have VIP summaries available, or there's a list of all our VIP summaries that you can get to from the homepage. Many of our pathways and VIP summaries have been published in peer-reviewed journals. This button will take you to a list of all of our pathways. We're going to move on to look at variant annotations and clinical annotations. Clinical annotations are summaries of the curated literature for a particular gene-drug association. This table shows all the clinical annotations that we currently have for codeine. We're going to take a closer look at this one. This clinical annotation summarizes the relationship between certain CYP2D6 alleles and the risk of drug toxicity when taking codeine. You'll see that each allele has its own description. Each description is written relative to the other alleles in the clinical annotation. On the left side, you can see the genes, drugs, and phenotypes which are covered by the annotation. All clinical annotations are assigned a level of evidence by PharmGKB curators. This shows the strength of the evidence supporting the association. You can learn more about our levels of evidence by clicking on the eye icon. Our levels of evidence run from level 1, showing the strongest evidence, to level 4, which indicates that the evidence does not support the presence of an association. Clinical annotations can move up or down levels as curators add new supporting or conflicting evidence. We use an algorithm to assign a level of evidence to our clinical annotations. Details of how the algorithm works are given on this page. There's also a link in the description below for a video which walks through each step of the algorithm. If we scroll down the clinical annotation page, we get to the evidence that has been attached to this annotation. We give a breakdown of the clinical annotation score and what types of evidence are attached to the annotation, then list out each piece of evidence underneath. You can see that the Cpic and DPWG guidelines that we looked at earlier in the video have been added as evidence, followed by evidence from research publications. Each one of these boxes is a variant annotation, which shows a single finding from a single publication. All relevant variant annotations are added to a clinical annotation, regardless of whether they support the association or not. You can look at each variant annotation in detail by clicking on the link at the top of each box, or you can go to the Variant Annotations tab on a drug, gene, phenotype, or variant page to see all the variant annotations linked to that object. Variant annotations summarize a finding from a paper into a single structured sentence, like this one at the top. We build these sentences using controlled vocabularies so they may not be in perfect English, but they're easier to computationally compare against each other. If there are notes or further explanation of the finding needed, this is added as free text below the main sentence. We also show information about the publication, and study parameters such as the size of the study cohort and any statistical analyses that were carried out. You can go back to the homepage at any time by clicking on our logo in the top left corner. We also have a pediatric focused version of PharmGKB that you can access through the link here or at pediatric.pharmgkb.org. The news button takes you to the PharmGKB blog, where we post about new content and changes to PharmGKB. You can download our data as TSV files from our downloads page. These green buttons link to our introductory pages to pharmacogenomics on the left and PharmGKB on the right. If you're new to the field or to PharmGKB, these pages are a great place to start to familiarise yourself with our work. Our resources section provides links to useful pages and materials on our site, such as our cancer pharmacogenetics page and COVID-19 page. You can also find our gene information tables, which are a series of tables that can be used in pharmacogenomics research and implementation. These tables are available for all genes covered by Cpic recommendations. Finally, if you need to send feedback or ask a question of the PharmGKB team, you can use this button, which is displayed in the bottom right corner of every page. We try to reply to all user messages as soon as we can. If you have any questions about the material covered in this video, please contact us at feedback@pharmgkb.org. Thank you.